Finally, I welcome you all and truly appreciate joining me today for the online study circle of Rohini Ekai for Padhivakta Parishad on the topic Contour and Analysis of Consumer Act 2019. It is an absolute privilege that to enlighten us on this topic, we have with us a very distinguished speaker, Honorable Judge Sanita Dinda Pintaji, the former Judge Jenny Hattu, and Madam is currently presiding over the Delhi State Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. Also have with us designated senior counsel of Supreme Court of India, Shri Sukumar Patakrishnan. Hi, on behalf of Padhivakta Parishad, Rohini Ekai, welcome you, let's thank Honorable Justice Sanita Dinda Pintaji and Sukumar Patakrishnan
for sparing time for us from their very busy schedule. Namaskar, sir. Namaskar, ma'am. As the saying of John Quincy Adams says, if your action inspire others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, you are a leader. And your ladyship is a true leader in every sense. She needs no introduction. Still, for a former compliance, may I give a small introduction of your ladyship. Your ladyship did her schooling and graduation from Chandigarh and obtained her law degree from University of Delhi in the year 1981. And she completed her LLM in 1983. She subsequently did her PhD from MIT University in the year 2012. Justice Sehgal was a topper in her batch in 1984 in Delhi Judicial Service and joined the service in July 1985. Justice Sehgal served as Registrar General to Delhi High Court and from April 2013 to December 2014, she was the Registrar General of Delhi High Court and she also worked as Registrar Vigilance. She was elevated as an additional judge of High Court on December 15, 2014, and she became the permanent judge of 2nd of June 2016. Currently, your ladyship is the chairperson of Delhi State Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. Being a trained mediator, Justice Sehgal has trained number of lawyers as well as number of judicial officers. Justice Sehgal has also authored several books, including Women Know Thyself, on different laws relating to women in India. She has also authored an exhaustive guide to the Slum Area Improvement and Clearance Act 1956 and Relevant Rules, which was published in 1998. Madam, we welcome you on behalf of Adhivakta Parishad Rohini Ekai. Our other learned guest for today is Senior Advocate Shri Sukumar Patta Joshiji. Shri Patta Joshiji is one of the topmost lawyers of Delhi. Having done his master's in social work from Delhi University in year 1983, sir passed his LLB from Campus Law Center of Delhi University in the year 1986. Sir enrolled as legal practitioner in Bar Council of Delhi in the year 1987 and started practicing in Supreme Court of India and various high courts of and various tribunals, various commissions. Upon attainment of professional competence and continuous contribution in the legal field since 1987, sir has been designated a senior advocate. He has been actively participating in the welfare of legal fraternity and his contribution was duly recognized by lawyers. He has been elected thrice to the Executive Committee of Supreme Court Bar Association, including his term as Vice President of Supreme Court Bar Association in 2018. He is one of the few lawyers who practice all branches of law like civil, criminal, arbitration, original and appellate side. He was in the prestigious Group A panel of Central Government for Supreme Court of India. He has represented various PSUs like BSNL, MTNL, Food Corporation of India, Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, and many sizable corporate bodies. Sir is one of the senior counsel appearing for parties in 2G spectrum allocations campaigns, coal block allocations campaigns, and many other cases. Sir has had a steady success in resolution of complex constitutional issues. He is also actively engaged in development sector and he works for welfare of victims of crime. And he is active votary of substantial development and biodiversity. I would like to add that since I had an opportunity to view a few lectures of sir, sir is an immensely articulate speaker also. We welcome you, sir, on behalf of Adhivakta Parishad Rohini. Thank you. Now we begin with the keynote address. However, if anybody has any questions, they are requested to kindly message them. And the question will be answered at the end of the address. Now, I would request Justice Sangeeta Dhingra Sehgal ji to share her views on the topic. Over to you, madam.
Thank you. Good evening. Namaskar. I must say I'm honored to be asked to speak on this platform today on the topic Contours and Analysis of Consumer Protection Act 2019, which is of great importance not only for advocates but also for the general public. I have been told that we have a mixed audience today, that is, there are members outside the legal fraternity who are also attending this webinar. Therefore, I plan to give you all a primer today on India's consumer protection laws from the standpoint of a layman while tracing the legal history of the consumer laws from 1986 till 2019. Let me start with a hypothetical. The year is 2020. Aman is a person who recurrently purchases electronic products. He purchases a brand new mobile phone which has been marketed by the phone maker, containing cutting edge technology at a competitive rate. Aman decides to purchase the new phone using an e-commerce website which promises speedy delivery and guarantees genuine products. Aman places his order and a phone is delivered. On opening the phone, it turns out that the phone is defective and does not offer the facilities as stated in the e-commerce website. On charging the phone heats up and explodes. Aman contacts the e-commerce company as well as the phone maker. Both refuse to entertain Aman's grievances. Aman is naturally furious and feels cheated. Aman wants a remedy for his grievances. More importantly, he wants justice. Going to a civil court seems to be a tedious process. Aman, being a layman, cannot comprehend the nitty-gritties of the code of civil procedure. Filing a criminal complaint accusing the companies of cheating seems intimidating. Both the reliefs require the presence of a legal professional whose fees might be more than the cost of the mobile phone. Aman is confused. This is where the consumer commissions come into picture. The Consumer Protection Act was established to provide people like Aman a simple and a straightforward procedure without hindrances. It will allow him to draft a complaint, file it with the Consumer Commission, after which the commission determines whether any deficiency of service or an unfair trade practice occurred. Aman will not have to go into any legal complexities, which are often entertained by the civil and criminal courts. The Consumer Protection Act 1986 and subsequently 2019 were enacted for this purpose. The Act was promulgated at a time when India's consumer goods industry was starting to take over and the government started recognizing the important role of consumers as stakeholders in the development of Indian economy. The Act originally focused on curbing cases of adulteration, ensuring good quality products, and preventing the consumers from getting cheated by the sellers. Moreover, the Act aimed to provide justice which is less formal and involves less paperwork, less delay, and is less expensive. Since the inception of the Consumer Protection Act in 1986, the litigation and the consumer commissions have been evolving. The Consumer Commission over the years have entertained cases in different categories. These include areas with respect to airlines, automobile, insurance, housing, banking, and financial services, etc. The procedure envisaged under the old repealed act is incidental to the new act. Let me explain how the act envisages a simple procedure which is layman friendly. The complainant, on having a grievance with a seller of goods or a service provider, can file a consumer complaint before the Consumer Commission. The consumer complaint has to be presented before the registry of the consumer commission. Depending upon the monetary value of the case, the consumer can approach the relevant commission, the district commission, the state commission, and the national commission. In legal parlance, we generally refer to this as pecuniary jurisdiction. Further, the consumer complaint has to be accompanied with a court fees, which is to be submitted in the form of a demand draft or along with the postal order. Every consumer commission, the hierarchy, that is the district commission, the state commission, the national commission, will require a different court fees depending upon the value of the case. Moreover, as a judge, I have often come across cases where consumers are appearing on their own. At times, the consumer only files a complaint but does not attach any supporting documents to establish his or her claim. It is therefore very important that whenever a complaint is filed, the consumer should also attach the supporting documents. This does away with the first step, that is approaching the commission consumer court. Now, the second step which sets the whole case into motion is the first hearing, more popularly known as the hearing on admission. This is where the court decides whether the case is maintainable at all. At this stage of admission, we often adjudicate on few things, such as whether the case is within the limitation period, whether there exists a cause of action in the complaint, whether the case falls within the territorial or pecuniary jurisdiction of the relevant commission. A complainant appearing before the consumer commission who is aggrieved by the unfair trade practice or deficiency of service is expected to satisfy these questions. Once the preliminary questions on admission are satisfied, we admit the case and issue notice to the opposite parties. The opposite party against whom the deficiency of service or unfair trade practice is alleged is then asked to file a written statement within 30 days of receiving the notice, extendable to 45 days. In fact, the Apex Court, in its recent judgment of New India Assurance Company Limited versus Hilly Multipurpose Cold Storage Private Limited, which was decided in January this year, that is 2020, has clearly held that the right of the respondent to file a written statement shall stand closed if the same is not filed within the time frame provided under the Act. So that means the written statement, if any, is to be filed within 30 days, extendable for 45 days. Beyond that, the time cannot be extended. After the filing of written statement by the opposite party, an opportunity is granted to the complainant to file a reply to the written statement, also generally known as rejoinder. The parties are then directed to file evidence by way of an affidavit. The statement by way of affidavit is under oath, and any false statement made in the affidavit can attract the offense of perjury. The parties are then asked to file a short brief of their written arguments, and the matter is then listed for final arguments. Both the old and the repealed, as well as the new Act, the whole process starting from the date of receipt of notice of the complaint to the opposite party till the case is disposed of, is to be completed within 90 days. Unfortunately, because of some practical constraints such as pendency of cases and unnecessary adjournment by parties, the whole process often takes much longer. Now, coming to the new CPA Act 2019, most of you must be thinking, why did the Parliament enact a new law? They could have easily amended the old Act, right? The new Act brings in new modes of business like telemarketing, direct selling, multi-level marketing and e-commerce, which were not envisaged 3 decades back, have made consumers more vulnerable to the unfair trade practices. The existing legal framework, the 1986 Act, rules, guidelines, and circulars issued by the Consumer Ministry had failed to address these emerging issues. Earlier, direct selling and multi-level marketing were regulated through guidelines issued by the state governments and the Consumer Affairs Ministry. The new Consumer Protection Act brings these activities in its fold. The Consumer Protection Act 2019 is much more extensive than the erstwhile Consumer Protection Act 1986. It has covered more areas by introducing substantive provisions and has also changed some pre-existing areas of law. Let me explain this by a few examples from the 2019 Act. The new Act gives more power to the litigants as well as the Commission. For the litigants, the 2019 Act provides for a wider set of rights which were never envisaged under the 1986 Act. It also takes into account the constantly changing consumer industry. There are 4 major changes which has widened the set of rights for the consumers, which are the addition of the section on product liability, the insertion of provision related to unfair contract, introduction of e-commerce rules, and introduction of mediation. Let us start by understanding product liability accordingly. The term product liability was not defined under any other Indian law. It is the Consumer Protection Act 2019, which has explicitly laid down the foundation of the product liability regime in India. The introduction of product liability in the Consumer Protection Act 2019 allows the complainant, that is the consumer, to make a claim for product liability against the manufacturer, seller, or service provider from whom the product is bought or service is availed respectively. The liability arises when the product contains a manufacturing defect, where the product is defective in design, where there has been a deviation from the manufacturing specifications, and the product does not conform to express warranty, or where product fails to contain adequate instructions of correct usage to prevent any harm or any warning regarding improper or incorrect usage. The legal threshold for invoking provisions relating to the product liability is that there should be a harm done to the consumer as a result of a defect. An interesting point related to product liability envisages principle of absolute liability. It will be interesting to see how the litigation concerning these areas will pan out in the years to come. The new Act has inserted the definition of unfair contract. This definition was never present in the old Act, and the Commission was often in the conundrum in interpreting contracts which were often shaped unfairly against the consumers. For example, one of the most common grievances often raised by the consumers in the course of their arguments were that the buyer's agreement have an unfair compensation clause. The consumer complainant would often point that the penalty was delayed payment in some contracts would go as high as 18% of the buyer. On the other hand, if the builder delayed possession of the subject matter property, it would often be at a substantially lower rate. This would produce undue pressure on the buyer to pay on time, but at the same time, there will be little to no pressure on the builder to deliver the subject matter property on time. It is often claimed that the case of the compensation should be determined on principles of equity. When consumer commissions have often gone beyond the relief provided in buyer's contracts while awarding compensation in favor of consumer complainants, the express provision of unfair contract provided in the Protection Act 2019 does much more service to the consumers. I'm just trying to differentiate what is the new act says and what the old act. Under the new act, a contract between a manufacturer or trader and consumer will be deemed to be unfair if it causes a significant change in rights of a consumer. Contractual terms which specify excessive security deposits, unilateral termination of contract without any reasons, imposing penalties on consumers for breach of contract, which is wholly disproportionate to losses incurred, are among the several grounds which render a contract unfair. The 1986 Act did not provide consumers with any relief against such unfair provisions of a contract. I must say that there is a great leap forward. One of the most important aspects of the new Act is explicit inclusion of the e-commerce. The Consumer Protection E-Commerce Rules 2020 will soon be applicable to all electronic retailers registered in India or abroad, offering goods and services to the Indian consumers. These rules are mandatory in nature, and violation of these will result in penalties as decided by the Consumer Protection Authority as well as consumer courts. According to the rules, the e-commerce sellers will have obligation to display the total price of goods and services offered for sale along with the breakup for the other charges. They are also required to mention the expiry date of goods offered for sale and the country of origin of goods and services that are necessary for enabling the consumer to make an informed decision at the pre-purchase stage. E-retailers have to display details about the return, refund, exchange, warranty, guarantee, delivery, shipment, modes of payment and grievance, redressal mechanism, and any other similar information that may be required by the consumers to make informed decisions. E-retailers are also not allowed to manipulate the prices of their goods and services offered on their platforms, making any unreasonable profits. Further, the marketplace e-commerce intermediaries are exempted from liability as provided under Section 79(1) of the Information Technology Act 2020, IT Act, if they take an undertaking from each seller confirming that the goods and services being offered on the platform are accurate and correspond to the product description. Moreover, e-commerce entities are required to display prominently to its users details about the seller offering goods and services, including the name of their business, whether registered or not. They must also display seller's geographic address, customer's care number, any rating or other aggregated feedback about such seller, among others, as per the new rules. This is a step towards the larger discourse of consumer rights to have information about a product and its seller. Now let's go back to Aman's hypothetical with which we started this discussion. With the inclusion of the new provisions such as e-commerce rules as well as product liability, Aman has strong remedies without approaching the civil and criminal courts. In fact, as discussed above, product liability attracts absolute liability, a remedy which is absent in many beneficial legislation. But things don't end here. The Consumer Protection Act 2019 has more for Amun. The provision related to mediation has also been inserted, which were not present in 1986 Act. Section 37 of the Act allows that the District Commission on the first date of hearing after admission can direct parties for mediation subject to the case being fit for mediation and the consent of the both the parties. Therefore, if the Commission feels that Aman's case is fit for settlement through mediation, it can ask both the parties to give their consent within 5 days and thereafter refer the matter to mediation. Mediation is the need of the hour as it offers speedy and efficient disposal of consumer cases and will reduce the burden on the consumer commissions. Moreover, mediation also creates an alternative source of revenue and is therefore a welcome step moved towards the roster of jobs in the recent times of uncertainty. While there are few prominent rights for the consumers under the new Act, there are also a variety of provisions which empower the consumer commissions and other authorities. These provisions will assist us in ensuring a strict enforcement mechanism and in making sure that the consumer rights are not curtailed by unscrupulous practices. First, the introduction of the Central Consumer Protection Authority is one of the most important aspects of the new Act, which was not present in the old one. The old Act merely had a Consumer Protection Council. The main objects of the council was to promote and protect the right of the consumers. The new Act provides for both a council and an authority. The council's function has been reduced to an advisory board. The Central Consumer Protection Authority now serves as a regulator. As per the new Act, the Central Consumer Protection Authority performs the duty of promotion and enforcement of consumer rights as a class and protection against unfair trade practices and violations of the rights of the consumers. The Consumer Protection, the CCPA takes on an activist role. This is because it empowered with an investigation wing headed by a director general for the purpose of conducting an inquiry or investigation. Let me explain how the procedure under the CCPA works. CCPA is like a watchman. Main aim is to enforce consumer rights as a class. If one feels that an organization, business is involved in malpractice, which affects the rights of the consumers as a class, or if the organization is resorting to unfair trade practice or misleading advertisements, they may make a complaint to the CCPA in writing or via an electronic mode. One can also write to the district collector of the area who will be responsible to inquire, investigate in that area. The CCPA will then conduct an investigation on the alleged violation. The legal threshold for calling off for an investigation is that the information provided to the authority should display a prima facie violation of consumer right, unfair trade practice, misleading advertisement. The CCPA is also interested with suo moto powers. They are empowered to file a complaint before the consumer commissions based on their investigations or intervene in any ongoing proceedings. Moreover, on receiving the complaint and after a preliminary inquiry, if there seems to be a violation of consumer rights, then the CCPA is also empowered to refer the matter to a regulator. Most importantly, the authority has been entrusted with the power to recall goods or withdrawal of services. So once the investigation is completed, the authority is satisfied that there exists sufficient evidence, they can issue orders for recalling goods which are dangerous, hazardous, or unsafe. They can also order the seller to reimburse the purchaser the price of the goods or services which have been recalled. The authority can further order discontinuity of goods, services which have been recalled. Appeal against the order of the CCPA lies with the National Commission. The new Act also has provisions related to the e-filing, which empowers this commission to serve consumers who cannot physically approach the commission. This has not received much attention in many academic or media circles who have discussed the working of Consumer Protection Act 2019. I, however, feel that this is a great leap forward in making the consumer commissions more accessible. The proviso of subsection 1 of section 35 of the Act states that the consumer complaint may be also filed electronically. Think about it, Aman, from my hypothetical need, not even leave his home. He can simply visit the website of the Consumer Commission and file his complaint electronically at any hour. Since I have mentioned this, I would also like to inform you that the Delhi State Consumer Commission Dispute Redressal Commission will be starting the e-filing procedure to comply the new Act on tentatively on the 4th of September at 4 p.m., which is being inaugurated by the Honorable the CM of Delhi and the Honorable Food Minister. The new Act empowers the District, State and National Commission with the power to review orders. Previously, the 1986 Act only granted the power of review to the National Commission. This power was inserted in Section 22 of the amended Consumer Protection Act 1986. However, now the District, State and the National Commissions can review the orders passed by them. The provision related to appeal have also been changed. As per the old Act, the appellant had to deposit an amount of rupees 25,000 or 50% of the amount awarded, whichever is less, a prerequisite of filing an appeal towards the State Commission. If the appeal was before the National Commission, the appellant had to deposit an amount of 50,000 or 50%, whichever is less. The provision related to the deposit of amount as per the new Act is uniform at all levels of hierarchy, that is the state and national level. The appellant now has to deposit 50% of the amount awarded. That means no minimum sum needs to be deposited. Instead, a set percentage of 50% has to be deposited irrespective of how large the amount awarded is. This will create a deterrence towards litigants who file unnecessary appeals. Litigants will now only file an appeal where they feel that their appeal stands on a strong footing. This will reduce litigation and unnecessary burden on the appellate courts. According to the new Act, the limitation period of filing an appeal has been changed from 30 days to 45 days. This has also been a significant change in the provisions related to territorial jurisdiction of the Commission. I'm sorry, I'll just take a minute. As per the repealed old Act, the territorial jurisdiction of the District and the State Commission was based on where the opposite party resides or carries on its business or has a branch office. The territorial jurisdiction of the commission also existed where the cause of action wholly or partly arises. As per the new Consumer Protection Act 2019, there is an addition to the already existing criteria for determining territorial jurisdiction, that is where the complainant resides or where he personally works for GAIL. These two criteria have increased the scope after territorial jurisdiction of the district as the state commission. This inclusion of the complainant's place of residence has been important in the larger discourse of the complainant's access to commission. Change in the pecuniary jurisdiction will be a hotly debated issue. According to the 1986 Act, The district commission had a pecuniary jurisdiction up to 20 lakhs. The said commission between 20 lakhs and 1 crore, and matters upwards of rupees 1 crore were with the national commission. The pecuniary jurisdiction was decided according to the aggregate value of all goods or services in question, along with the compensation claimed by the complainant. As per the new act, the pecuniary jurisdiction of the district commission is still 1 crore. The state commission can entertain matters between 1 crore till 10 crores, and the national commission will deal with cases above 10 crores. Notably, the wording of the provision related to the jurisdiction have also changed. The new act uses the word consideration paid and has omitted the word compensation, which would mean that the pecuniary jurisdiction of this commission will not only be determined based on the value of goods and services, instead it will be determined on the consideration paid by the complainant at the time of instituting the complaint. In a sense, this will also reduce the number of cases which will have original jurisdiction of the consumer forums and will change the role of the state commission to an appellate nature. Obviously, class action suits where consideration paid is more than 1 crore will find their way as original complaints, but it will surely reduce the burden. The flip side to it is that it will burden the district commissions. Lastly, the new act has empowered this commission to impose higher penalties for offences being committed under the act. The penalties are in the form of long prison terms and carry high monetary fines. The penalty for non-compliance of direction of the CCPA carries a prison term up to 6 months of fine, which may extend to rupees 20 lakhs. In fact, the commission has the power to sentence the manufacturer, seller for life imprisonment, who by selling an unadulterated product has resulted in the death of a consumer. Section 90 and 91. Such empowerment to the commission through high penalties will ensure high compliance with the Consumer Protection Act 2019. These powers were not vested with the commission under 1986 Act. In the previous act, the Consumer Commission at best could punish a seller manufacturer for imprisonment of a term between 1 month to 3 years. With this, I conclude, and before parting, I must point out the positive things which I have highlighted about the new act will not be visible immediately, but will be seen in the years to come. As a judge, even if I'm interested in seeing the changing jurisprudence of consumer rights. Thank you all for being a lovely audience today.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your valuable knowledge in such a crisp manner. Now, may I request Sir Patta Joshi ji to enlighten us on this topic. Over to you, sir.
Good evening. I appreciate Adhivakta Parishad for organizing regular basis study circles on various topics, for enlightening the persons who are interested in gaining knowledge and knowing things around us, particularly during a time when we are under a so to say lockdown. Lockdown in a sense for lawyers, I say that because courts are in physical format, not allowing anybody to come. And otherwise, the corridors of the court were the great learning grounds for sharing our knowledge and discussing about materials. I particularly thank Abhishek for inviting me and giving this platform to share my thoughts on the friendly aspects of the new Consumer Protection Act 2019. It was quite enlightening to hear the most erudite and comprehensive talk from one of the most relevant speaker, Dr. Justice Sangeeta Dhingra Sehgal, who is in the helm of affairs in the consumer protection field today as the president of this State Commission of the National Capital. Madam Dhingra has comprehensively dealt with anything and everything that is relevant today to the consumer protection world, and I hardly have anything to add to that. Anyway, I'll make an attempt in my own way to share my thoughts and expect my audience to gain some aspects of the consumer protection law as it stands today. I'll be analyzing whether it has become more consumer friendly over the years, and if so, in what ways? Does it make a marked difference to the consumer? What I will not say, let me specify first. Unlike my other speech on consumer protection, where I primarily speak on the philosophy and fundamental principles of consumer protection, I refrain from speaking on those topics today because the most relevant and newest aspect of consumer law today is the Act itself, that is Consumer Protection Act 2019. And I am eager to share the consumer friendly features of the Act, which according to me will ensure better protections to the consumer of goods and services. But I will not start straight away to that, to the Act. I'll give a context. And the context will be irrespective of any statute, whether it is the 1986 statute or the earlier statutes also. There are so many statutes, like your Insurance Act, your Medical Council Act, your Food Adulteration Act. There are many other consumer-friendly acts, or the recent RERA. Why the consumer protection laws are needed, and whether the new act serves the purpose better than the earlier act. Let's see this. Why do we need this? We all know we live at a time and space where almost everything can be bought and sold. And this is with the liberalization as a consumer, our freedom and choices have appeared to be substantial. Those who have lived through the 70s and 80s of the last century would readily recall and feel bad about it, that situation, your compulsions, like the long queues for getting a telephone connection, the long queue for buying a car or a Bajaj scooter, which were the only goods or the equipments or the services available in that sector. So with the liberalization of 80s and 90s, many car manufacturers came, many other telephone equipment service providers came, and so therefore the services eased out, and we thought that we have a Now the problem of the consumer being dependent or subject to monopolistic ideas of the service provider will be over. You see, it appears that substantially, but ironically, our lives have come to be governed by markets and market values. In fact, when liberalization came, the opening up of markets and deregulation thereof were considered that they will do a lot of good to promote the liberal market with the conviction that the markets will hold key to the prosperity and freedom and for achieving overall public good. But things did not work out that way. The reach of the market went much beyond, and the greed took over, and the need for consumer protection in a statutory way were felt very badly. The consumer protection was looked as an instrument needed primarily to address the disparities in consumer and supplier relationship. You know, what is the difficulty? Why do we need a consumer protection? Why do you need a trade union? This logic is same. Consumer protection you need because you have two sets of unequal bargaining power parties. The suppliers are much stronger in terms of bargaining power, in terms of knowledge, in terms of resources. And therefore, the need for consumer protection to balance out these things and to regulate the supply side for providing equilibrium by balancing the strength of demand side and supply side and for ensuring a safe marketplace for the consumer. I will not go further in this and straight away come to the Consumer Protection Acts. The Consumer Protection Act 1986 laid an excellent foundation for better protection of interest of consumers with some framework and mechanism which proved useful in achieving the goals enshrined in the preamble of the Act at that time. Then why was the change needed? It was needed because meanwhile, the consumer market of goods and services have undergone drastic changes. The reach of the market has increased with the development of e-commerce and emergence of global supply chains of goods and services touching almost every sphere of life. Due to the diminishing market morality, the consumer is flooded with misleading advertisements, unfair and one-sided terms of contracts. Just think of a situation particularly involving multi-level marketing, telemarketing, direct selling, and e-commerce. In these, you know, there is no choice to disagree with one-sided standard terms for completing the transaction. These factors aggravated the inequality in bargaining power. meeting the supply side, that is goods and supply and provider supplies, services, and demand side, that is the consumer, which necessitated and culminated into a robust and renewed consumer law in the form of Consumer Protection Act 2019. The Act of 2019, according to me, is revolutionary and is set to transform the consumer jurisprudence and is much better equipped to keep the consumers protected from the evil effects of the expanding market. In fact, you can see the acts. These are the acts, if you know. This is the Act of 1986. Even numerically and visually, the new act is much stronger. I'll just don't take it. This is literally I'm saying. The 86 Act had only 4 chapters with a total of 31 sections. Whereas the 2009 Act has 8 chapters with 107 sections. So that itself speaks that it is more elaborate and has taken note of detailing. Of course, legislation is a very evolving process, and you can never say that this covers everything, because there is always a scope for evolution, and it is need-based, because today the e-commerce market and the ingenuity of the supply side necessitated certain changes. So the old act gave way to the new act. What are the consumer friendly features? Of course, Madam Sehgal has said many things, all aspects almost like that. But I'll, at the cost of repetition, I'll just elaborate a few things of that. I'll not touch the entire because of the time constraint also. Now it's almost going to be 5. The consumer-friendly features of 2009, according to me, will ensure better protections and will strengthen the rights of the consumers. In what way? Firstly, an entirely new thing has been added to this. In fact, it's not very difficult to find out what are the changes. In fact, if you see the Bayer Act, there is also a few pages in the beginning itself. It gives a comparison, right, of the tabulation, which are the provisions in the old act corresponding to the new act. So therefore, you don't have to remember anything. You simply have to see that what is not there in the old act, and you can readily find that. So in that, the first thing which has been introduced and incorporated in the chapter 3, over about say 17 sections, that is section 10 to 17, is Central Consumer Protection Authority. This is introduced and is given very wide powers to do what? To investigate, promote, protect, and enforce the consumer rights. Earlier, you had only one mechanism of the courts, that is the district forum, state commission, and the national commission, and the Supreme Court. That is a court system. This is an additional forum which eases out many things. I'll just spell out. This can additionally intervene to prevent harm to consumers arising from unfair trade practice, initiate class action for the benefit of consumer as a class by enforcing recall, this is very important, please note that, refund and replacement of products. They can enforce refund and recall. Say, for example, a batch of medicine is found to be faulty, or a batch of cars has some defective parts emitting additional level of, you know, pollution. So they have the power to recall that. You say that you take, or if they have sold it, they direct in general that to whomsoever you have said, take back the cars or the medicines and give the money back. So this is what CCPA can do it so much. And also replace, they can direct replace the products to the consumers. The introduction of CCPA, in a way, eases our task of consumer as a class to approach the consumer court or any other court by way of public interest litigation or class action after mustering all evidence in support. As you know, if you go to the court, whether it is in any capacity, you'll have to collect material for that so that you can substantiate your case, even if as a group you are going. But CCPA is in a much better position and they are empowered to order investigation and direct the supplier himself to give evidence. Supplier or the manufacturer, they can ask that, you say that this pollution level is much more in your cars, you provide the data, you provide the evidence. The consumer doesn't have to look for that. So necessary evidence will come through directly to them, they can order that. The second change, which is also sizable in terms of making the consumer a king in the whole affair, is that consumer has been empowered by ease of filing complaints. This is one additional. The new act gave you one additional authority called Central Consumer Protection Authority. Now, what more? In the existing ones, what you get? The consumer has been further empowered by ease of filing complaints with the district commission within whose jurisdiction he resides or gainfully employed. Till 20th of July, till this new act was notified, you could only approach a forum where the opposite side resides gainfully or does business or cause of action arises. So you have to, if you have gone to Chennai for a treatment, then you will have to file a complaint in district forum in Chennai. You cannot file a complaint if you are a resident of Delhi in Delhi. But today, with this, the ease of filing, that where I stay, where the consumer stays, he can file a complaint at the nearest consumer forum. This is also further, which Madam was also elaborating, that he need not go to any place also. Say, for example, the jurisdiction is beyond that and he has to file in a higher forum. He need not travel anywhere. He can also file electronically, which will reduce the logistical and jurisdictional challenges and make it truly inexpensive. He can file by electronic mode. This is what the Section 34 says. Now, the third change is it can be filed electronically. What is the fourth change that is also under Section 34 and which is of a very great and far-reaching consequences? In fact, a lot of debate on this will involve many lawyers, litigants, consumers and service providers on this issue. That is the pecuniary jurisdiction definition. Section 34.1 of the new Act talks about pecuniary. It says it has simplified the consumer dispute adjudication process by enhancing the pecuniary jurisdiction of Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission so that higher claims can be filed with the nearest district commission. Mind you, one small change, but you must have noticed now the forums are not called forums, they all are commissions. So it is at district level also, district commission, state commission, national commission were already existing. So further to the advantage of the consumer, the pecuniary jurisdiction has been limited only up to the consideration paid. Similarly, enhancing the jurisdiction of district commission, the other commissions 1 crore, 10 crore and above, enabling them to file complaints in the lowest available forum. And mind you, the best good news is there is no capping on the relief that can be granted by the lowest forum. Like most, many of my colleagues who are practicing in district courts other than the presidency towns, etc., like those who are in different states where the original jurisdiction of civil courts are unlimited. It is like this, that the for judging the jurisdiction, it is the consideration paid. But there is no capping on what kind of a relief can be granted by the lowest fora. So far as granting of relief is concerned, there is no embargo, and the jurisdiction is identical in original jurisdiction of that of National Commission, State Commission, or District Forum. And therefore, it may so happen. Say, for example, I'll give you a case of a medical negligence. Say, for example, a high net worth individual who is a billionaire goes to a hospital and gets an injection administered as per the advice of the hospital. The turns out to be something negligently administered injection, and he suffers damages. The cost of the treatment was 300 rupees only. So perforce, as per this act, he'll have to go to district forum. But the loss caused to him or to his family in case of any death is immense. It could be more than 500 crores. So therefore, because of the typical definition here and the embargo here, he'll have to go to the district forum to claim the requisite compensation. And he can do that. Similarly, in an insurance matter, what is consideration paid is the premium paid. So he can take a very huge policy, but premium paid will be the factor which will entitle you to approach which fora, which commission, district, state, or national. So there also you can seek your claim as per the provisions of law and actual damages and this. So therefore, it is really empowering to the consumer that at doorstep and also electronically, you can go to the nearest fora for seeking your redressal. Just because you have to claim a big compensation, you don't have to travel to New Delhi. And that is, I think, is a landmark beginning of consumer rights. This is truly in favor of the consumer. Secondly, I'll say that to the poorer consumers, there is no fee for instituting a complaint for some minimal claim. Hopefully, the redressal and closure. Now, this is another important thing. This you will find in section 38, particularly clause 7, that how serious they are about the speedy disposal. Of course, it was there in the earlier act also, but you know, there are other difficulties faced by other courts also. That's why we cannot achieve that. But here, I am hopeful that the redressal and closure of disputes will be faster as to ensure timely disposal and to discourage unnecessary adjournments. This is section 38.7. The provides for imposition of cost by commissions for adjournments. And they'll have to record reasons for adjournments. That is a great thing, you know, that will really discourage adjournments. Filing of frivolous appeals is also discouraged, madam also said that, by stipulation of a minimum deposit of 50% of the awarded amount as precondition for hearing of appeal of the opposite party. With this objective, the early settlement will become a reality. To add this early settlement, there is a whole chapter, that is chapter 5, for mediation. So mediation is statutorily incorporated In fact, you would know the whole thing of this started with a decision of Justice Goyal in Supreme Court that National Commission should, or the Consumer Protection Forum should always try for a mediation in the first instance. That was recorded in an odd judgment as an advisory. And the government has taken note of that problem. And a chapter has come with that. And the very first effective section of the adjudication process, that is section 37, provides that reference to mediation should be at the first hearing or thereafter. So first endeavor, first choice is that we must try to sort it out. Many things, many disputes also arise due to lack of communication. So that can be eased out in the beginning. Parties know their pros and cons. So they may like to settle because they are in a totally, blank and clean slate. Then the seventh advantageous and consumer-friendly addition to the new act is the expansion of the unfair trade practice. Earlier, as you recall, the definition, Section 2 of the old Act, had illustration A to H. There are only, up to A to H, that is, six kind of unfair trade practices were recognized. Now there is an addition of three more, and they are like this. If the buyer is, they are very important, and they are left out, and I think in the age of e-commerce, I think that's much more relevant. If the buyer is unsatisfied, I'll just spell out all those three. If the buyer is unsatisfied with the product, he can return the product within 30 days. And in case the seller does not accept the return, the same would amount to unfair trade practice. In case any personal data of buyer, so the first one is that in 30 days, if he wants to return the goods, the seller is bound to take it back. If he doesn't, that is the first added unfair trade practice. The second one is, at times while purchasing certain things, he gives your personal data, maybe for a lottery or something, he says that there is a scheme, etc. But if he reveals the data to any other purpose or for his own purpose, that also will amount to unfair trade practice. He can't trade with your data. And the third and most important, if some trader or service provider fails to give you a receipt towards the purchase or service render, then that also will per se amount to unfair trade practice. Now the eighth new edition and friendly edition is in form of chapter 7, that is from section 88 to 92. This provides that the penalties and offenses for products containing adulterous, spurious goods, etc. So this is very drastic and all-encompassing. This reminds me of the earlier Companies Act, where, for any violation, there can be prosecution, etc. So this probably has been borrowed from other things, but this is something which is going to make the act a complete code. You can punish for anything. It need not be directly related to your case or something, but this makes the power of the authorities very, very, very real and strong. So this is one more consumer-friendly feature. Then, there is a special provision for prevention of unfair trade practice in e-commerce and direct selling. In Section 94, this is specifically incorporated. And especially it is said that unfair trade practice, it prohibits it. Then the 10th additional feature which I see is in terms of Chapter 6, which is incorporated in Chapter 6 from Section 82 to 87, is about the very, very new thing called product liability. Earlier, what used to happen, say, for example, you buy a pressure cooker and it turns out to be defective. Under the earlier Act, if you file for defective goods, you will get either compensation or refund of the consideration for the goods. So that was your claim only for the product. But now product liability means, say for example, because of the defect in the pressure cooker, it bursts and bodily injures some people or destroys one wall of your kitchen or something like that. So any harm that is suffered due to the defective product or defect in product manufactured, service or product sold to him can entitle to sue the manufacturer or seller, or as the case may be, service provider, to that. Say for example, a wrong administration of a wrong drug or something, you know, causing something. So the product liability is a new thing and is a very welcome change in this, and an entire chapter is devoted to that, and will make the consumer really empowered in the sense that whatever actually loss they can claim. Earlier they could claim only part of it, which is peanuts. This reminds me of some cases, in fact, in the past, which I had done. Say, for example, in an earthquake, a building constructed and sold by a builder collapses. And it was found that it collapsed because of the manufacturing or the construction defects or the structural defects, and not only because of the intensity of the earthquake. And the inhabitants of the, or the residents of the house were in fact killed, or they got or severely injured or something. So now, because of this product liability clause, they'll also be entitled to claim for the bodily injuries or the loss of life or anything else the case may be. So that is a very, very important, and something which was felt for a long time has been incorporated. I'm really grateful that the legislatures have taken great care in meticulously including this new thing. Then the 11th new thing and consumer-friendly input is, it regulates now the misleading advertisements and penalty for misleading advertisements. It provides for penalty for misleading advertisements. And when, in what situation, if that causes prejudice to the consumer's interest. It is too early to debate, in fact, that what sort of an advertisement can be prejudicial to the consumer's interest. One definitely comes to my mind is, say for example, somebody advertises that taking a particular drug will readily make you a superman, right? And in effect, it is seen. Say for example, now some drug, I'll not name, was going on that is effective for corona, right? And they were marketing it in a very big way, because somebody would advertise, you know, that sage essence, etc. So in that sort of thing is prejudicial to the consumer's interest. Consumer gets carried away and consumes that. So without any benefit or something, if that is found, then those things now can be dealt with under the Consumer Protection Act very effectively. In two ways. I've already told you that the newly created body, that CCPA, can also deal with that. And the consumer protection, like the machinery, existing machinery, can also deal with that. So this is very important. The action can be taken both by a central authority against the manufacturer, trader, endorser, advertiser, and publisher. Everybody can be taken to task depending on the situation. And this is, now I come to my 12th additional and friendly feature of the new Act, which in fact now makes, of course, it is only relevant for state commission and national commission. It doesn't percolate down to the district court. Is they can declare any unfair terms of the contract as null and void. Earlier, you know, if those who have been practicing in consumer protection would recall the famous judgment of Justice Ravindran. There they say that these consumer courts can't look into this, because they'll have to only apply the terms as it exists. They can't interpret that. But now, and they can't declare something unfair or something. Now the statute says, clearly empowers, that they can clear these terms unfair Madam Sehgal, in fact, in the erudite lecture already said that now, gave an example also of that unfair clause. There are many, in fact, there will be many unfair clauses, particularly in the online marketing kind of a thing, there will be a plethora of unfair clauses. The standard form contract is that, and you are bound to agree to all of them, because otherwise your online marketing form will not get completed, your transaction will not be through, because unless you say, he'll not give you the option to pay. So therefore, now this gives the clause, declare any unfair terms null and void. I'll also say that the all the three foras, the district commission, national commission, and state commission, are now additionally, that is for the benefit of the consumer, why I'm saying, given the power to review. Only national commission had that power to review in the old act. Now section 40, 50 and 60 respectively provides rights to review, the jurisdiction to review their own orders to the district forum, state commission and the national commission. Sorry, I'm using time and again district forum, but it's district commission, they should not mind. And so this is also a new thing. Otherwise, earlier, you know, if there is a small order, something, you know, in the past, like a non-prosecution order or a dismiss in default, the state commission or district forum could not set it right, even if the party comes or the consumer comes or the other side comes. And it had to go for another round of litigation to New Delhi for this national commission to say that, all right, now it is remanded for fresh adjudication, etc. So that will be now, that will be curtailed, that time will be curtailed. The other aspect which you can see, I don't see that to be greatly a consumer-friendly aspect, but in the interest of evolution of law, there is a second appeal provision in cases, you know, from, look, like the state commission has jurisdiction to pass two kinds of orders. One is in the original jurisdiction, one is in the appellate jurisdiction. Earlier, the order passed in appeal would only be amenable to a revision to the National Commission. Now, under section 51.2, a second appeal, in case which involves substantial questions of law, there can be a second appeal. So even if it is an order in appeal by the State Commission, a second appeal can be filed before the National Commission. So that is another feature which is better in the interest of evolution of the consumer law. I will not say that is consumer friendly or not, but the law will be benefited in the, and the larger interest of the consumers may be that way. Second, there is a power now, of course, that is only to the National Commission under section 61, power to set aside ex parte orders. That, of course, could be done, in fact, otherwise. If you have a review power, that could have been done, but now that is, there is a specific power given under that. Also, another intention of the legislature, which has to be read, to show that this act is out and out to strengthen the consumers, can be gathered from the fact that there is no equivalent provision like the one existed under section 26, where a frivolous or vexatious complaint could have been dismissed with cost up to 10,000 rupees. There is the act, to my reading, is, if I'm wrong, please correct me. There is, to my reading, there is no such provision in the new act. So therefore, even by mistake, some consumer files some vexatious complaint, no consequences. So therefore, that is also empowering, because in his judgment, he thought that that's a nice case, but the court may come into the conclusion, may interpret that, that the complaint is actually frivolous. So, but they cannot be punished for that. So these are some of the new changes. And I think with this, the consumer will be greatly benefited and strengthened What I'll just give my own opinion on this, actually, and a rider. By creating CCPA, to the philosophy of consumer protection, or if you analyze from the point of view of the United Nations guidelines on consumer protection, what great good can it do to the consumers or Indians as a nation? And also I'll come to that on the electronic part also, I'll come a little that what kind of additional rights can it offer to digital citizens? Because now today, when there is concept of e-governance, etc., etc., and e-marketing, so the citizens can also be have certain rights as digital citizens. I'll come to that later. Let me first talk about CCPA. Look, for the effective and better protection of consumers, as I already told you, by the state itself, creation of CCPA is a very welcome and appropriate measure. The objective is to protect consumers. What could be the objective? I'm just only, this is my input. I'm not too sure, but there can't be anything wrong in this because this coincides with the UN guidelines. The objective is to protect consumer as class from inferior or unsafe products. Manners of misleading advertisement on unfair practice. The regulator such as CCPA will be effective to regulate suppliers, which is the avowed goal of consumer protection, to engage in fair competition. They say that don't get into all this coterie and things like that. Allow fair competition. And fair competition means only the quality products at affordable price will stay in the market. Otherwise, other goods will find their way out. They will exit. And the second point will, second benefit will be to provide full information. They can also now force the suppliers to provide full information of the product, to observe all laws regarding safety and quality, to compensate to the consumer if any problem arises with your product. So all these things are, you know, are the avowed goals of consumer protection. This is a wider part of consumer protection. So this can be achieved readily by this. It may also bring about economic efficiency by ensuring markets for high quality products at competitive price only. You know, bad quality products will go out because if regulated, they can't have a sustained growth in the market. Also, it may secure the individual rights of citizens to be treated with dignity and by the market. So that is what we also need, you know, as a consumer, we need to be respected. So far as the question, right, and regarding this is concerned, I think CCPA will serve a great deal. And then second, I'll conclude now by saying that what is the difficulties we may face by this? Only a word of caution. As I said, now most of the majority of the original complaints will be instituted and entertained by the district commissions. The infrastructure needs to be upgraded quantitatively and qualitatively. I'm sure, in fact, the government is mindful of this, but that is an area mostly will come with the state governments. And our experience, as you see till now, in many states, even the state commissions and district forums are almost defunct. Say, for example, J&K, after the change in the laws, does not have a state commission or consumer, because earlier they were governed by J&K Consumer Protection Act and the appeal from the State Commission would come to the Supreme Court, not amenable to National Commission. Now, what will happen to the consumers in that state? Till now, there it is not constituted. And you imagine, Northeasts, I was speaking, in fact, last week, I was speaking to them, to their legal aid service authorities. They had organized a seminar. Hardly anything is working there. So in that scenario, sending back all matters without first preparing an infrastructure, I leave it at that. Do not wish to complete that sentence also. Second, my wish in consumer. What, according to me, should have been included or can be included in the Consumer Protection Acts, either in times to come. Of course, I must be very circumspect. It is very difficult, I understand. It is very difficult to point out as to what has been left out in the new act. Because this is result of a meticulous effort of lawmakers. But as a lawyer, you know, as a practicing advocate, I feel that the new act is lacking clarity about what will happen to the matters filed under the earlier act and seized off by different folders. You know, the new act should have given a direction what will happen to the existing ones. Now, of course, all the state commissions, district forum, as is where is basis, they are managing that because of an administrative circular passed by the president of the National Commission. But I think law should have done much more than that. The clarity should have come because, you know, there are various acts when the jurisdiction changes that provides what will happen. Say, for example, Delhi High Court, if you are aware, when the pecuniary jurisdiction changed, the matters were sent back to the lower forums where the jurisdiction was there. Similarly, there that UP Urban Land Ceiling Act was repealed in 1999. So that time it was said that everything lapsed, whatever were pending there. Similarly, in the Fair Compensation Act, that the Land Acquisition Act, there they provided what will happen, you know, to the existing and things like that. So that is one area I think the act should have clarified, or it can still clarify by notification. Because now it has to be judicially determined otherwise. Of course, they all will stick there, but it has, needs to be judicially determined. Further provision for proper consumer education and wide publicity of consumer rights should have been mandated. Because, you know, these are all remedies you are providing, but you must also make provisions for, you know, increasing awareness, increasing how they will get their rights known, etc., you know, and there should be, you know, like you created CCPA, you also create a body which will impart, you know, consumer orientations, which should have, like, you know, the Gram Sabha should have a wing which will train the villagers how to use consumer protection to their advantage. So these things, I think, should have been also provisioned. Then, you know, certain cases, which, of course, I have been a strong votary from the beginning, like medical negligence, there should not be any consideration criteria in that. If, whether it is the service is provided free of charge or with money should not matter. Because, you know, your the service provider, whether he is taking money or being paid by the government or from the taxpayers' money, but he is providing a service and playing with the life of somebody for negligence, how can the consumer be said that, no, you are not consumer for this purpose to approach the forum? I think that that could have been like there is an explanation that for the purpose of livelihood, right, if some goods and services are used, that can be, that there will be an exemption, that they'll be not treated as commercial purpose. Similarly, I expected something like this for medical negligence, that everybody, irrespective of whether they are paying to the hospital or the hospital is charitable, should have been included. And this is also same for education. This is also same for education, my point. It should have been there. Then the other things I'm saying, that data protection should have been made a chapter, like unfair trade practice, etc. So today, you know, what is the strongest stock in trade? It is the data. So data protection should have been, because when e-commerce is coming, you must, otherwise you'll have to make amendments in every year. So data protection should have been an area, should have been taken care of, and provision should have been made. That is what my view is. And so if there is loss of personal data, say for example, you know, now the data is kept in medical hospitals about my treatment. I need not carry a physical file with me. So that if that is lost, then, you know, there should be some actions for that. Then I also feel that deficient service rendered by state-sponsored educational institutions, healthcare service providers, and civic bodies who are responsible for providing civic amenities should be made actionable under the Consumer Protection Act, irrespective of service availed without any payment or otherwise. And I also think that the time has come to welcome and empower a digital citizen to participate on consumer protection governance. So with this, I conclude, and I again am grateful to Abhishek. Also, I have received a message from Abhishek directing me to conclude. Thank you so much, Adhivakta and Adhivakta Parishad. And it was quite nice to be with you. It's a privilege I'll cherish. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was an extremely interesting experience.
स्क्वायर में तो ये आ रहा है ना, रिमूव सेम एडिट नेम एडिट और नहीं लिखा भाई, जहाँ पे हाँ जी नहीं बना
Thank you so very much. It was an extremely and enriching experience. We are privileged to hear you, and we are going to carry a true and deep understanding of the topic addressed by you. Though we had kept a question answer session also, but the session was so informative that almost all the queries of the viewers are satisfied, even before my putting them before our eminent speakers. Thank you so very much, Your Ladyship, and thank you so very much, sir. It is certainly a privilege that we can never be so grateful for this. Now, I'd like to conclude the session now, and I'd like to congratulate the organizers of this session. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Namaskar.